The following program is brought to you by Total Theater Online. The views expressed do not necessarily represent those of the staff or management of WGBB. You're listening to the station that serves your community, 1240 WGBB. And now it's time for Dave's Gone By with David Lefkowitz.
Well, there goes the neighborhood. Welcome, everybody, to the 107th edition of Dave's Gone By on this December 23rd, 2004. If you've got the jingle blahs, if all is not calm and all is not bright, and you're not joyful, and you're not triumphant, and your heart is not light, if you feel the hopes and fears of all the years, if you can't help but cry and pout, if all you want for Christmas is your two Tylenol, if you feel like locking Donald Rumsfeld away in a manger, if you can't gather winter fuel because OPEC is cruel, if your boy in Baghdad won't be home for Christmas, if you want Karl Rove to get run over by a reindeer and an SUV, if you feel like the MTA has your nuts roasting on an open fire, if you'd like to take Frosty's corncob pipe and stick it in an orifice on Governor Pataki that even Paris Hilton hasn't had violated yet, if all your Christmases are white, but you're black, if your prostate has the consistency of figgy pudding, if you saw Mommy kissing Santa Claus, but she wasn't kissing him on the mouth, then you are in the right place for the next 57 minutes, because this is the holiday edition, the holidayve edition of Dave's Gone By, an hour of comedy, talk radio, music, and more. Brought to you every Thursday night at 7 p.m. on this station, WGBB AM 1240 in Freeport, New York, and live streaming on the web at davesgoneby.com. Just click where it says, "Can I listen on the web?" And yes, you can listen on the web. It's not archived. You can only listen on Thursday nights when the show is being broadcast live. But if you're not in Long Island, if you're not in Queens, if you're not in a place where the show comes in clearly on your wireless, browse on over to davesgoneby.com and you can listen there. As I mentioned a couple of shows ago, there is big news afoot. I would say within the next 4 to 6 weeks, a way to listen to some older episodes of Dave's Gone By also on the Internet. Unfortunately, it's hellaciously expensive to archive entire programs and keep them resident on a website where, you know, you can just click any time and listen to any one of the 106 episodes we've done before this one. But at least you'll have a weekly chance to catch some of the ones you missed or might enjoy hearing again. I was hoping to have the details on that before the end of the year. Might take another week or two beyond that, but it is pretty much a done deal. So I'm very excited about that. And of course, you can also listen to older episodes of Dave's Gone by owning them. We've put literally dozens of them on CD, complete with a nice cover, jewel case, track listings, not too late to give as a New Year's gift, and they're on sale through the end of the year. Just $12 a piece. That includes shipping. Each episode is complete. A full hour of small talk, silly talk, smart talk, special talk, and music, which is what we try to do here on Dave's Gone By. For information, again, please visit the website davesgoneby.com. Hey, now how's that for some nice holiday shilling? I mean, that's all we've been subjected to since the end of October. Ad after ad after ad. Buy this for Christmas. Get this from Santa. Stuff your stocking with these drastically reduced items. Give oversized tips to your garbage man and parking garage attendant so, you know, that your trash isn't magically strewn across your backyard and your car doesn't wind up looking like Dick Ebersole's jet. Forget about paying the piper. You've got to pay the paperboy. And don't forget that $5 knick-knack for the Secret Santa at your office. How are we capitalists supposed to stimulate the U.S. economy if we don't support factories in Korea, Japan, and Manila? After all, those are the same factories our kids will work in one day. And it just goes to show you that Christmas is just for Christians, but the national debt is for all of us. And if you can't do your share, don't expect anything more from Santa than a lump of coal and a cut-up credit card. If you can't spend beyond your means, You don't deserve Christmas.
Christmas time is here, by golly, disapproval would be folly. Deck the halls with hunks of holly, fill the cup and don't say when. Kill the turkeys, ducks, and chickens, mix the punch, drag out the dickens. Even though the prospect sickens, brother, here we go again. On Christmas Day, you can't get sore. Your fellow man you must adore. There's time to rob him all the more. The other 306, a T, a 4. Relations, sparing no expense, oh, send some useless old utensil or a matching pen and pencil. Just the thing I need. How nice. It doesn't matter how sincere it is, nor how heartfelt the spirit. Sentiment will not endear it. What's important is the price. Hark, the Herald Tribune sings, advertising wondrous things. God rest ye merry merchants, may ye make the Yuletide pay. Angels we have heard on high, tell us to go out and buy. So let the raucous sleigh bells jingle, hail our dear old friend Kris Kringle, driving his reindeer across the sky. Don't stand underneath when they fly by.
Hey, baby, for a good time, don't call me. Read Dave Lefkowitz's book, Marriage, Babies, and the End of the World. It's got all these funny comedies in it that make you laugh, that make you think, that make you, ooh. Marriage, Babies, and the End of the World, 516-295-1511, or davesgoneby.com. If you like Dave on the air, you'll love him between the covers.
Welcome back to the Yule Snide edition of Dave's Gone By, brought to you by Total Theater, publishers of Performing Arts Insider, and by Hewlett Minuteman Press, printers of anything you need, copied, bound, unbound, or on the rebound. Just a reminder that this holiday program is rated a semi-blasphemous DGB-13, the Dave's Gone By equivalent of PG-13. Actually, this episode might get a little closer to DGBR, so be warned. We don't nail Jesus to a cross, but we don't pull him down when he's up there either. Many times I've done my rap about how Christmas in this country now starts a week before Halloween. Used to be 3 weeks before the holiday, then it was the day after Thanksgiving, then it was November 1st. Now it's open season. The middle of August, Home Shopping Network is selling ornaments. Everybody wonders why Big Friday, you know, the weekend after Thanksgiving, all the economists and merchants wonder why shopping usually doesn't meet expectations. Why don't people buy or spend as much as the experts were predicting? Maybe it's because they've been Christmas shopping since Labor Day. Maybe they've already bought that cashmere sweater and DVD when they weren't part of a back-to-school sale. But hey, I'm doing my bit for the economy by selling my own high-quality crap just a day before Christmas Eve. This show could make the difference between a boom or bust in the stock market on Monday. Did people rush out and buy my CDs or my book just before the holiday? Or did they hold back? Did they think they might need the extra few bucks to pay for home heating oil in February, to put towards a health insurance deductible, to pay Long Island property taxes? Folks, saving money for boring necessities is just not the American way. Tucking your pennies under your mattress for when the cost of postage goes up next year, or when subway, rail, and bus fares go up again in 2 more years? I mean, where's the fun in that? America says your aching wisdom tooth can wait, but you need that flat-screen TV now. After all, it kills two birds, since watching television takes your mind off your moldering molars. America says the new car you lease today takes precedence over the furniture you're still paying off from 2001. America says give your kids that iPod they want, because that $100 won't put a dent in the college fund you can't afford anyway. So, ladies and gentlemen, in the full and true spirit of Christmas, in the holy and sacred power of the holidays, take that money in your wallet and give it to me. You won't need it, well, until tomorrow. If you don't want to buy my CDs, you're not interested in my book, how about advertising on the show? Nothing more Christmassy than that. Show your support for the completely deranged, outrageous, and enrageous things we do here. The rates are as inexpensive as we can make them, and they're posted on the website, davesgoneby.com. Give us a holiday gift by giving yourself one, because we'll reach all our listeners on Long Island and all over the world via the Internet. When people hear your ad on Dave's Gone By, they're going to think, wow, that store is pretty hip. That restaurant is way cool to sponsor a show like this. That plumber knows the true spirit of Christmas, giving to the needy, a.k.a. anyone working at WGBB, and being replenished by the giving. That's what Christmas is about, giving to our friends, to our family, to our fabulously entertaining radio hosts, and to our pets. So here it is, just weeks away from Christmas. You've shopped for your family, your friends, your special friends, and even bought a trinket for yourself. But oh my gracious, haven't you forgotten someone? Someone close to you, loyal, playful, full of love every day of the year? What, oh what, will you offer your canine companion? You can give your dog a toy that would make him leap with joy, or sneak your mutton cut of prime. But when Christmas time has come, something special must be done, something tasteful, not expensive, but sublime. You can spend a pretty dollar on a doghouse or a collar. You can pamper her or groom him till he grows. But the thing I like to do, and I know that you will too, is to shower the gift of love that overflows. I'm gonna give my dog an enema for Christmas. All dressed up in a Santa Claus disguise. Each yuletide without fail, I lift my doggy's tail and give his little poop shoot a surprise. I'm gonna fill his little anus up with bubbles and rinse his small intestines out with cream. I'll sing a little ode as Bowser's bowels explode. It makes the yuletide pass just like a dream. I'm gonna pump my pooch with Davium for Christmas and spike it with a pint or two of gin. I'll grease him up with lube and then insert the tube and stroke his burning muzzle as the tide rolls in. I'm gonna squeeze the water deep into his innards. No longer will he constipated be. I'll pump him till he's sore, and then I'll squirt some more, and maybe save a drop or two for me. Now some express dismay at this holiday display. They say, Dave, perhaps the doggy is in pain. I say, yes, his dogs are great, but my goodness, darling, when his doggy nose goes booming down the drain. And so I give my dog an enema each Christmas, and squeeze the bag of bleach with all my might. And God's a Christmas jar, come crying out his wrath, as he merry diarrhea, and to all the good shite. And if you're wondering what gift to get your spaniel, or how to make a wolfhound howl with glee, buy by a nozzle and a boom, and K.Y. for his home, and Bishop puts beneath the Christmas tree. I guarantee you'll have a merry, messy, tight spree, yes, sir, me, an excremental Christmas memory. That is not enough. That's what Christmas is about. Pets and children and the physical abuse they crave. But seriously, I'm not against all Christmas things. I like the idea of Christmas bonuses, of people being nice to each other and giving each other gifts, of people wanting to be more spiritual and connected to God, whoever that God may be. I can't help it if my God is just slightly less ridiculous than your God. I mean, you know, the Jewish Old Testament God is a vindictive, jealous, angry son of a bitch. He's really like an abusive spouse who's only nice to you when you're begging forgiveness for breaking his rules. But hell, that still makes more sense to me than the whole Jesus thing. I mean, here's the Son of God who makes trouble wherever he goes, but whenever he's asked to prove himself to save his own skin, somehow all his powers vanish. Herod was right. Jesus can raise the dead, but he can't do one lousy magic trick to save his skin from 39 lashes. And he dies on the cross because he's supposedly taking on the sins and sufferings of all mankind. Well, that's convenient. And it reads better than, well, he died on the cross because he was no more the Son of God than the Queen of Detroit. But let's say Jesus really wanted to make a point about dying for everyone's sins and proving he's you-know-who's kid. He should have still gotten crucified, screamed and groaned a little, well, you know, so Mel Gibson could make his movie, and then pried himself off the wood, whooped some Old Testament ass on the Roman guards who nailed him there, done some kind of big miracle with sheep and lemonade or something, and then we'd all believe. But the way it's come down, it's all fairy tales with a dash of sadomasochism and a twist of anti-Semitism. So, forgive me if I'm not completely in the Christmas spirit, especially this year, when the Passion of the Christ brought up that old wheeze about the Jews being the ones who killed him. How that is possible when the Romans were the judges, the jury, the police, and the executioners, I do not know. But nobody blames the Italians. They're the ones who come from Rome. My people come from Brooklyn. And after two millennia, it gets a little old hearing how your people are responsible for something they probably never did, something that possibly never even happened, and yet the first scapegoat anybody points to for anything, here we are. Well, you know, I'm tired of that. Patti Smith once opened an album by singing, "Jesus died for someone's sins, but not mine." Well, at this point, the Jews have suffered so much for the sake of this Jesus that I kind of hope we did kill him. It's like those people on death row who are exonerated after 20 years by DNA. Their lives were ruined, they were beaten, raped, their families torn apart. And after a while, you gotta think they almost wish they were guilty, because they're taking the rap anyway. And if the Jews are still gonna get slandered over the whole crucifixion thing, at least we should have had the fun and the satisfaction of killing the little pitcher. We killed Santa Claus, we killed Santa Claus, we killed Jesus too. Nailed him to a cross, no big freaking loss, just another cranky Jew. All our life was trouble and strife, from the Holocaust to pogroms. So keep J.C. away from me, he's worse than terrorist bombs. We killed babies, we killed children, use their blood for cake. We own Hollywood, we own Wall Street, take, 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 take. This is what you said about us for the past 2,000 years. Pound Voltaire and Charles Baudelaire and any boy who's had four beers. We killed Santa Claus, we killed Santa Claus, and we do it again. Goodbye carols, goodbye creches, no goodwill toward men. You've hated us since the birth of Christ, so we hate you in return. So stick your mask straight up your ass and burn Joan of Arc, bitch, burn!
Oh my God, this is terrible.
What?
There are 168 hours in a week, but Dave's Gone By is only on 1 hour long.
I know, I'm just on Thursday night.
But that's not enough!
Why don't you get my CDs?
CDs?
All my complete shows are on compact disc. $14 a piece, or less if you buy a bunch. Just go to davesgoneby.com. Fully packaged, and they make a nice gift, too.
Wow! My depression has cleared!
Great!
But not my psychosis. What chicken is this?
Inside Broadway, brought to you by Total Theater's Performing Arts Insider, your everything theater guide.
Winter is a schizophrenic time for Broadway. On the one hand, the season opens with a gold rush, as families and tourists flock to New York to see the tree, go out to dinner, and take in a couple of Broadway shows. But then, come January and February, it's the doldrums. People stay in, visitors stay home, and even some of the most popular shows on the street start hurting a little at the box office. Shows you can barely get into in the spring and fall are suddenly taking newspaper ads offering buy one ticket, get one free. It's a great time for Broadway bargain hunting, but that's after the holidays, when the kids are back in school and the holiday cheer has worn off. Right now is the time when a lot of parents and grandparents want to bring the kids to a show, perhaps their first. So I thought I'd give you a little rundown of what's playing on Broadway that might be right for the young folks, and medium young folks, over the Christmas and New Year stretch. Perhaps the most appropriate introduction for small kids is Beauty and the Beast, one of the longest-running shows in Broadway history at this point. It's colorful, tuneful, kind of loud, but that also drowns out the youngsters who don't yet know how to keep quiet in a Broadway theater. Pretty much every other show on Broadway right now isn't suitable for kids under 10, with the exception of The Lion King. And even that one, yes, there are puppets, and it's an amazing experience, but it's also rather long, with a pretty dark sequence in the second act. And more importantly, you've got grown-ups paying $100 a pop to be there, and they're not paying to see your child scream or talk or bounce up and down. So have a little courtesy, and this goes for any show, on or off Broadway. If your kid is not old enough to be there, please don't bring him. If you're already at the theater, and you're first learning that he or she is not ready to behave, leave, or at least move up to the balcony, the back of it. It's no shame, it's no crime. Kids are kids, and a lot of adults these days don't know how to behave in a theater either. Give it another year, and try again when the child is older. Which brings us to a lot of shows on Broadway that are appropriate for young teens, kids who've already seen stuff on cable TV and know all the words to rap songs, etc. Take them to the theater this holiday and catch any number of productions. Which are the best? I'll suggest a couple in a minute, but you can get a much more comprehensive answer, plus an encyclopedia's worth of other information about all the shows on and off Broadway, by subscribing to Performing Arts Insider Theater Magazine. That's right, Performing Arts Insider for 60 years, a Bible of the Broadway industry. New Testament, Old Testament, and Current Testament to the power and resiliency of Broadway. And PAI has never been bigger, never been better. In fact, for the January issue, they've made a couple of design upgrades and even added a feature or two just in time for the new year. Performing Arts Insider continues to offer an incredible amount of useful theater information in 50 fun-to-read pages. If you love Broadway, off-Broadway, off-off-Broadway, cabaret, dance, and opera, it's all there in Performing Arts Insider. 10% off subscriptions for Dave's Gone By listeners. Call 516-295-1511. 516-295-1511. And if you want to see a single issue before you subscribe, you get a Dave's Gone By discount as well, $10. Visit TotalTheater.com or DavesGoneBy.com for all the information. Or again, call 516-295-1511. 1511. Get the theater magazine the professionals get, Performing Arts Insider. It's Broadway the best way. Returning to Inside Broadway on Days Gone By, I promised to mention a few Broadway shows that are great for adolescents and young teenagers to see over the holidays. Now, I haven't seen Brooklyn the musical But from what I've heard, it has a dark moment or two, but a lot of energy and pop music. And if your kids are into American Idol, they'll probably groove on this. If your offspring already has some interest in the theater, you could go for one of the classics. 42nd Street is ending its long run on January 2nd. It's bright, it's tuneful, it's 42nd Street, with all those dancing feet, and just one rather disturbing moment when one major character does something not very nice to another. Fiddler on the Roof has a lovely new revival at the Minskoff, and these are the last 2 weeks to catch Alfred Molina and Randy Graff as Tevye and Golda. It's a long show, and there are a lot of sad scenes in Act Two, so do make sure your child's mature enough to handle that kind of emotion. There's also a surprising amount of dark material in Wicked at the Gershwin Theater, but it's quite a spectacle, with a good story and a lot to learn from. Highly recommended, especially for girls, because the show features two strong women with a lot of decisions to make, but it's a tough ticket to get. Well, speaking of girl-friendly shows, still in previews at the Virginia Theater is Little Women, the musical, based on the Louisa May Alcott books. The boys will probably want to see The Producers, if you can get tickets over the holidays. There's profanity and raunchy humor, and a lot of stuff you probably want to wait till they're in their middle teens to see. And Rent has a lot of appeal for teens, but watch out for the profanity, the AIDS themes, the sexual themes, the drug themes. It's not You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown. The same goes for Avenue Q, which looks like a cute puppet show, but believe me, wonderful as it is, it ain't for the kids. You can take the youngins to see Wonderful Town. It's got some very mild sexual content, but otherwise it's harmless fun for everybody, and Brooke Shields might be a draw for the girls and the pubescent boys. And most recommended, if you can prevail upon the kids to see something other than a musical, is 12 Angry Men. 12 ordinary guys with all their flaws and biases deciding the fate of a young man on trial for murder. It gets a little ugly, but it has to, and your family will have a lot to talk about when it's over. And if you want to read more about Broadway and beyond, get a copy of Performing Arts Insider by going to TotalTheater.com. I couldn't do this segment without it, and I can't end this segment without wishing you happy holidays, happy theater going, and happy times inside Broadway.
We've just been Inside Broadway with Total Theater and Performing Arts Insider. I've been telling you for months why you should use Hewlett Minuteman Press for all your copying and printing needs, but here's one of the owners, Mike Toron, to tell you why.
Hi, how you doing? At Minuteman Press, our ultimate goal is service. We are your best source for the most complete line of printed products. You can check us out on the web at www.hewlett.minutemanpress.com.
Wake up the global village! Get 18 UPI wonders to tell everybody! News, news!
And the news of the world.
My radio's on, the news is all bad, but it's good for a laugh.
Welcome back to Dave's Gone By. It's time for the news gone by. A look at world and local events of the past week from a you'll-be-sorry perspective. Priceline, Expedia, Orbitz, these are all places people go to get cheap hotels on the holidays. But here's a special even they don't have. The Travelodge in Covent Garden, England is offering a free overnight stay on Christmas Eve to any couple named Mary and Joseph. Said the hotel manager, quote, "We're trying to make up for the hotel industry not having any rooms left 2,004 years ago, and our hotel is definitely more comfortable and stable," unquote. It's a cute idea and a nice holiday promotion, but not original. Last year, the Tel Aviv Holiday Inn offered free lodging all 8 days of Passover to anyone named Moses. It was a disaster, actually, because for a week, no one could use a swimming pool. Well, not everybody's in the Christmas spirit this holiday season. The Daily News reports that a week ago, a drunken Mineola man attacked a nativity scene outside a Knights of Columbus. Otto Pinteros, age 38, allegedly hurled plastic figurines of Joseph, two sheep, and two magi onto Jericho Turnpike. He also vandalized the creche and was about to wreak havoc on the baby Jesus, but cops stopped him just in time. Asked by police why he felt compelled to trash all these religious icons, Ventura said he wasn't out to commit vandalism. He was simply rehearsing for a television show where he has a feature part on the Mike Tyson Christmas Hour. Storm in East Kentucky. The newspaper accidentally published a list of Santa Claus jokes, some of them sexually explicit, in last week's edition. Apparently, the jokes came through via the internet and somehow made their way to the hard copy before they could be pulled from the newsstands. Readers complained, of course, because the jokes were tasteless, horrible, vulgar. Jokes like this one. What did Santa say when he had a foursome in a Harlem brothel? Ho, ho, ho. What do Michael Jackson and Santa Claus have in common? They both leave little boys' rooms with an empty sack. Awful jokes. Unconscionable. Two little boys were spending the holidays at their grandparents' house. Before bedtime, they knelt and prayed. And the younger child started yelling at the top of his lungs, "Dear Santa, I pray for a new bicycle, and I want a new CD player, and I want a digital camera." And his kid brother says, "Hey, what are you shouting? Santa Claus isn't deaf." And the little one says, "No, but Grandma is." How do we know Santa is probably a woman and not a man? Well, men can't pack a bag, they don't answer their mail, and let's face it, delivering toys to all those children requires making a commitment. Well, male or female, you can see lots of Santa Clauses on television, from Miracle on 34th Street to Silent Night, Bloody Night. But now, in Llanelli, Wales, in the United Kingdom, they have Santa on a webcam. Now, it's not as benign as it seems. In the St. Ellie shopping mall, Santa has a little grotto where he meets kids and asks them what they want for Christmas. The parents don't trust him, so they're videotaping everything to make sure that lump in Santa's pants is just coal for the naughty. Not only that, the kids can't even sit on Santa's lap. They have to take a seat next to Kris Kringle just to guard against any hint of pedophilia. I don't know. I think that's going too far. I mean, apart from the cynicism it shows at a time of year that's supposed to be about goodwill toward men, it's also not fair to all the 8 or 9-year-olds who don't want a fire engine, who don't want an Elmo doll, who don't want an Xbox. What about all these poor, lonely children who just want a little love? A little furtive touching beneath the underwear. A little harmless bouncy bounce on Santa's North Pole. A little rubba rubba on his Yule log. My gosh, what has this world come to? If we're going to deprive our children of having their first sexual experience with an obese, unemployed alcoholic with jail tattoos under his red suit. Next thing they'll say, priests aren't allowed to administer the Eucharist by strapping the wafer to their foreskins. Loosen up, everybody. If a child is old enough to make a wish list and beg for a puppy, he's old enough to be interfered with by a jolly fat stranger. That's the true Christmas spirit in my book. 'Twas the night before Christmas, and all through the malls, Santa was bouncing young boys on his balls. The children would snuggle all deep in his lap, which is why Santa's suit had a secret front flap. His stocking was hung like a porn star in heat, as fidgety children would straddle his meat. The mommies would wander and endlessly shop, while Santa found 9-year-old cherries to pop. On Trojan, on Durex, on Hot Rod and Crown, his tree would light up when the children went down. With tears in his eyes and beer on his breath, old Santa would quiver with each little death. And when he was through, he'd give each child a buck. Ho, 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 he would say, and thanks for the... After every 10th child, he drank juice and rested, and gave candy canes to the tykes he molested. Only twice all day did he excuse himself to visit the men's room and bugger an elf. And when he was finished, he again took his place with a boy on his lap and a girl on his face. Then, outside the store, there arose such a ruckus that Santa stopped fondling an 8-year-old's tuchus. He said, "What the hell?" and jumped flat to the floor as a dozen policemen burst through the front door. "You, in a fat suit, you've got quite a nerve." "Yes, 12 inches long," said the jolly old perv. "That's not what I meant," said Captain O'Flynn. "Now put your hands up and your pecker back in."
"But what did I do?" Santa said with a shrug. "I just gave them affection and sex and a drug.
We know who you are, and it's not Santa Claus. You're just an old weirdo who breaks Megan's laws."
"But these children love me. They're all my new friends. So what if there's blood coming out their rear ends? I treat them as equals, regardless of class, 'cause Santa loves fairness, and an ass is an ass. Each child gets a chance to hold Santa's hand, to stroke Santa's beard and yank Santa's gland. From the brawniest jock to the scrawniest worm, all children are blessed when covered with sperm."
A full minute passed before the captain could speak, with a lump in his throat and tears down his cheek.
"Forgive me," he said. "I was quick to accuse. I saw all these youngsters with stained underoos. I just didn't realize you had such a heart. They're lucky to have you at this mega mart. Don't let us disturb you. We'll be on our way. Merry Christmas, dear Santa, and have a nice day." And quick as a wink, the cops left the store, and Santa went back to his underage whores. He looked at his penis, all hairy and bent, and said, "Thank God 5 is the age of consent." He saw one child laughing and said, "Hey, that's funny. I'm gentle compared to my pal Easter Bunny. Now line up in order and don't you get fresh. I'm harder than granite and crave sweet young flesh." He gave the kids candy. He gave the moms cash. He gave the whole town a venereal rash. And when the last child had been raped and defiled, Santa Claus looked at his winky and smiled. He stood up and leered and did a cute dance and tasted the smears that were left on his pants. The children said, "Santa, where is your sleigh?"
"Out there," he said, pointing to a black Chevrolet.
"Do you have any reindeer? Do you have any toys?"
"Just the ones I used on you, girls and boys,"
said one little girl, still rubbing her rear.
"Please tell us, dear Santa, you'll be back next year."
Santa paused for a moment, then leaned down and kissed her.
"Of course I will," he whispered, "if you bring your sister. Now carry my suitcase. I warn you, it's heavy."
And quick as a wink, they were off to his Chevy. The engine did rev, and the tires did screech. The upholstery smelled of whiskey and bleach, and beer and tobacco and dog diarrhea, as off Santa went to the next Galleria. And they heard him exclaim, as he drove off the lot, "Merry Christmas to all! God damn, that was hot!"
Finally, in the news gone by, well, it was only a matter of time that wax figurine nativity scene at Madame Tussauds Museum was attacked this week. This is the one with David Beckham and Posh Spice as Joseph and Mary, with Kylie Minogue as an angel hovering overhead, and George Bush, Tony Blair, and the Duke of Edinburgh as the three wise men. It's been a popular but controversial London exhibit since it opened, and finally, someone came by, knocked over Mary and Joseph, and did some minor damage to the figures.
Museum spokespersons defended the tableau, saying it isn't sacrilegious, it's just meant to be a playful, modern take on the New Testament. And besides, if people are so upset about this nativity, wait till they see the Easter exhibit with O.J. Simpson as Salome and Nicole Brown Simpson as John the Baptist. And that's the news gone by for December 23rd, 2004. Please send your comments, criticisms, and anatomically correct wax figurines to Dave's Gone By, P.O. Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. Once again, that's Dave's Gone By, Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. You can also email me at davesgoneby@aol.com. We reserve the right to read your letter on the air, name withheld upon request. You can send New Year's greetings, Old Year's greetings, cards, letters, boxes, but please, no more Santa Claus puns. It's starting to rain, dear. Back after this.
And that was news. Yes, that was news. That was very, very, very special news.
Oh, honey, you turn me on. I'm a radio.
That's right, Joni. I turn you on all week long for a bunch of shows on WGBB, like Wednesday nights at 11 for psychic astrologer Joyce Keller, hosting radio's longest-running psychic advice show. She knew I'd say that. Thursday nights at 6, an hour before Dave's Gone By, it's WGBB Tonight with Larry Davidson. And then, right after my show, Smooth Jazz, The Instrumental Invasion with Mike Shimeri at 8. Friday nights at 6, Bonnie D. Graham has advice about being single and singular on Long Island's dating. It's a madhouse. It's a zoo. It's Mikey and Jimmy Saturday night. And then on Sundays at 7, Joe Salzone offers conservative politics with a sense of humor and an open mind on your world.
If you're driving into town with the dark cloud upon you.
Dial in AM 1240 WGBB for Joyce Keller Wednesday nights at 11, Larry Davidson Thursdays at 6, yours truly at 7, Mike Shimeri Thursdays at 8, Bonnie D. Graham Fridays at 6, and Joe Salzone Sundays at 7.
Call me at the station, the lights are all day.
Hi, this is Hillary Cantor, and you're listening to Dave's Gone By on WGBB.
You know, even on this show, it wouldn't really be Christmas without a couple of carols, and so we have two songs from a couple of good friends of the show. We'll begin with gay activist Peter Fitzgerald doing a song, followed by a vintage 2002 recording from the one and only Rabbi Sol Solomon, here on Dave's Gone By. Oh, oh, oh. I'm having a gay Christmas, just my lover and me. We got a goose in the oven, and vibrating novelties on the tree. I'm having a gay Christmas, makes me feel so young. The lights are glowing, the wind is blowing, and the stockings are well hung. I'm having a gay Christmas, carolers at the door. Each one gets a flavored condom. If I can put it on them, I give them one more. I'm having a gay Christmas, shouting ho, ho, ho. I sing and dance and unzip my pants underneath the mistletoe. Now too many people are too uptight as they miss the beauty of the silent night. But ask my partner, that's not how I am. Well, I poke his log and he smokes my ham. I'm having a sissy Christmas, full of yuletide cheer. I'm greasing up my chimney pie. Between you and me, Santa's queer. He's bringing a load of presents, I'm gonna wear them all. And if candy canes and sticky stains, I'll return them at the mall. Now Christmas is a wonderful word, the sexiest word I ever heard. It starts with Christ and ends in ass, and ooh in between for a great big mass. I'm having a gay Christmas, just like Jesus did. The thought of him kissing Judas makes me want to molest a kid. No, I'm having a gay Christmas, eggnog by the fire.
rise and fantasize about the Vienna Boys Choir. Now Christmas is a time of joy for every girl and especially boy. And on December 24th, Santa's pole points north, north, north. I'm having a gay Christmas. You'll log on the tube. I'm making my special icing and basting the goo with KY lube. I'm having a gay Christmas. Fruitcake spilled with rum. I shake and bake until I make all ye faithful come. Hurry, Santa, please. I'm on my knees.
Christmas. More like 12 days of Taurus, if you ask me.
On the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me nothing. On the second day of Christmas, my true love gave to me nothing again. And nothing on the first day, because I'm Jewish. On the third day of Christmas, my true love gave to me one more time. Nothing. Nothing on the second day, nothing. Goodness, on the first day, I told you I'm Jewish! On the fourth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me not a damn thing. Nothing on the third day, nothing on the second, nothing at all. Damn it to hell! On the fifth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me, why was I born? I don't get any presents. Nothing on the third day, nothing on the second, nothing, nothing, leave me alone! On the sixth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me, I don't have a true love. I've been married for 36 years, and I've given her 5 golden rings. Helps me acquaint with Bonkus with a shrew. Foreskin I don't have, Trinity I don't need, Tu B'Shvat is boring. One mother-in-law I got, you wanna, huh? On the seventh day of Christmas, my true love gave to me, what have I been saying? Haven't you been listening? I've been getting nothing. Why should I get anything? Can't you tell I'm Jewish? Margie, you retarded. Oi, how I hate the holidays. On the eighth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me, listen, if I didn't get anything on the first 7 days, why the hell would I get something on the 8th? Please, use your brains. Do I look like Santa? Yes, I have a beard. No, I don't have reindeer. I've never seen a reindeer. Although, apparently, they're kosher, but I still didn't get anything on the first day. On the ninth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me, now wait. What? Hold on. What was it? I'm thinking it was, oh yeah! Nothing! God, I hate this music. Everywhere you go, every radio station, even in the toilets. It belongs in the toilet. It's not like on Hanukkah, we make you listen to the dreidel song in the mall. Whatever happened to separation of church and state? And why does my prostate hurt? Can someone tell me that, huh? Why does my prostate hurt so much? On the tenth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me an Uzi so I could shoot myself, so they can bury me in Mount Shalem Cemetery in Farmingdale. So maybe I'll have a little peace for once. Only the Goyim will show up, and instead of leaving rocks and flowers on my grave, they'll decorate my tombstone with ornaments and lights. Even in death, they torture me. But you know what? It would be worth it, because I'd be dead. And I wouldn't have to wait online for an hour at Kmart to buy a pair of socks. And I wouldn't have to watch uplifting Christmas movies with Tiffany Amber Thiessen in them. And I wouldn't have to hear the phrase stocking stuffer ever again. On the 11th day of Christmas, my true love gave to me one blood libel. God forbid, I'm just kidding. Look, it could be worse. Jews have it pretty good in this country. We can worship, we can vote, we can buy retail, we can celebrate Hanukkah as if it were Christmas just to make our children really confused. We can live where we want. Well, maybe not certain sections of Scarsdale. We can eat in kosher restaurants. We can run for president. We can control the media, or at least that's what they say. Except if we did control the media,
Why the hell are there so many uplifting Christmas movies with Tiffany Amethy singing them? On the 12th day of Christmas, my true love gave to me high blood pressure, low blood sugar, 10 oppressive commandments, 9 days of fasting, 8 days of Hanukkah, 7 days of Shiva, 6 days of work. Why was I born? 4 say the questions, 3 things sustain us, 2 sets of dishes, and the cartridge in my Uzi. Merry Christmas, do you happy Hanukkah Jews? Season's greetings, everyone. Peace on earth. Goodwill for your sofa.
If you're a good American, that means you like to own things. Well, now's your chance. You can own a piece of my show. That's right, Dave's Gone By is ready to promote you. If you have a product, event, or service to hawk shamelessly, you can buy 30 or 60 seconds of advertising time on my show. You can even be a sponsor. Just imagine. This week's News Gone By is brought to you by you. We'll be right back after this word from your product. Advertising on Dave's Gone By is cost-effective and reaches listeners not only on Long Island, but thanks to WGBB.com all over the world. To get a piece of the Dave, call 516-295-1511 or email davesgoneby@aol.com. To see our disgustingly low ad rates, check our website, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. Remember, you could be talking to you right now. Are you listening?
Welcome back to the final moments of this Christmassy 107th episode of Dave's Gone By. If you had a few laughs, a few things to think about, please support our sponsors. Hewlett Minuteman Press, 1315 Broadway in Hewlett, Long Island. No job too big or too small. If you can bring it, they can copy it, print it, or laminate it. 10% off for Dave's Gone By listeners. And you also get 10% off if you subscribe to Performing Arts Insider Theater Magazine. Everything a theater lover needs to know about Broadway and beyond. Visit TotalTheater.com for more information. And keep visiting WGBB AM 1240 for more programs like Long Island's Dating, a show for singles and single-minded solos, Friday nights at 6. For other questions about romance, predictions, and prophecies, check out Joyce Keller, Radio Psychic, Wednesday nights at 11. For more funny stuff, it's the Mikey and Jimmy Show, Saturday nights at 5:30. And for serious and funny talk about news and politics, catch my pal, Joe Salzone, 7 p.m. Sundays, and then Thursday nights. Well, that's a no-brainer. 6 o'clock, it's Larry Davidson hosting WGBB Tonight. Then right after him on Thursdays, me, Dave's Gone By, till 8. But don't change the station, because right after this show, it's Mike Shimeri playing light, smooth jazz on the Instrumental Invasion till 9. And then I'm back. Yes, I have another program, quite different from this one, on this station. It's called Filler Up, Thursday nights at 9. It's an hour of music. I do a little talking, but mostly I play a very eclectic mix of folk and pop and jazz and classical and reggae and whatever else feels right at the moment. And tonight, we go from mellow to mosh with birthday salutes to Dido, Tim Hardin, and Pearl Jam's Eddie Vedder. That's all at 9 p.m. So stick around another hour or two, and also come back next week for the New Year's edition of Dave's Gone By. Should be a fun program. I might play a couple of best of 2004 bits. And as cynical as I was about the holidays on this week's Dave's Gone By, I tend to be a bit more sentimental and nostalgic on New Year's. I generally do a reasons to be cheerful kind of thing, too. A bunch of reasons why, even if the year was horrible, there were some things to be grateful for. Certainly every week, I thank the folks at the radio station, like program director Tom and my engineer buddies, Joe and Curry. I want to thank Rabbi Sol Solomon and Peter Fitzgerald for their contributions to tonight's festivities. And my wife, Joyce, who seems incredibly cute and sweet and normal, but a couple of those rhymes you heard tonight, don't blame me, they were hers. But
Those are my personal thank yous this week. Next week, a whole bunch of reasons why 2004 was not a bad place for all of us to spend 365 days. And please feel free to drop me a line and remind me of any good things or happy surprises of the past year that I might overlook or that were particularly special to you. George Bush and Baghdad and gas and oil prices and health care costs and Vioxx and the FCC and the MTA. All of that doesn't take away from the good stuff. What was the good stuff in 2004? You'll have to tune in next week to find out. December 30th, Thursday night, 7 o'clock, for the 108th edition of Dave's Gone By. Until then, don't miss your days going by. This is Dave Lefkowitz. Good night, goodwill toward men and women, and transgendered and children and pets, constipated or otherwise, and gone by.
Your nuts roasting on the subway seat. All the people looking grim. Rushing about, putting merchants to rout. These folks would trample Tiny Tim. So don't slip as you go rushing on the grimy ice. Don't let slush get in your shoes. Forget when you're tired and you're wet. Merry Christmas, you. So we don't put the sails in place, the bat flashes through the night. Been up so long since the fuse is for wrong, and the sweet trees burned up with light. Everybody knows that people just don't give a damn what each other think or do.